All right, begin with. Congratulations on getting this far. You've obviously worked hard and written a good proposal, and I know that you wrote a good proposal because 19 you did two and we lost. So yours must clearly have been much better. So that's the good news. The bad news is it gets harder from here on. Somebody asked me many years ago what I personally think it took to be a successful project manager, and I said, well, there's a couple things we need to get out of the way right away. First off, you pretty much give up your personal life, well, it's not your new launch, and give up about 2 to 3 hours of sleep a night from now to launch, and then the rest of it will pretty much fall into place. And so that's something that you can live, the PIs and PMs can look forward to. It's not already obvious. I've chosen to take a little bit different tack with my talk today. Far be it for me to tell JPL, Intel, and others how to manage their projects better. You know that, or you wouldn't have gotten this far. So I'm going to be talking about implementation issues that you didn't have to face when you wrote your step one proposal, but will become very much a part of your daily life if you're selected for the next phase. Obviously, as a project manager, your first responsibility is to implement the mission the way your PI envisioned. Now, I've personally been fortunate enough to have been part of the proposal teams for all the missions that I've managed, and so being there with the PI to make those priority decisions, instrument selection decisions, mission operations, and staffing decisions made it a whole lot easier to live with those decisions down the road. Now, I'm going to be talking a lot today about what life as a project manager is like in the new world, in the 21st century world of earned value management. It is not like some of the other comments that I've heard this morning where they look at cost and plan and all that stuff. Now, we're way past that, so we're not in Kansas anymore. Now, because the value of these missions is way over $50 million, you will have a statutory responsibility for implementing a validated earned value management system. Now, that's not just ANSI 748 compliant. That's having a government agency validate your system. And I'm sure my friends from JPL will agree that is a torturous, long, and expensive process. I won't take temptation to get into why we're going to do that, but anyways, as a project manager, you're going to be responsible for implementing an EVM system on your project. That means includes things like selecting someone to lead that process, all of your cost account managers, which are unsuspecting engineers whose lives will be ruined by now being responsible for generating revenue, more reports than they ever had to do in the past. You'll be responsible for selecting which performance metrics you want to use. And I'm going to talk a little bit later about the fact that choosing the wrong metrics can not only not help you, it can give you a completely erroneous picture of where you stand and where you can walk the bad decisions. The other general point I want to make is that all the EDM metrics in the world won't fix anything. They will give you as a PM enough information early that if you're paying attention and you've selected good metrics and you know where the metrics came from, you got time to make a decision before things get out of hand. But they won't fix anything. So, start off, as a PM, you're going to be responsible for implementing your earned value system. You're going to be responsible for implementing your cost tracking system. That includes allocating your budgets to your cost account managers, tracking those cost performance, and most important, reacting to negative variances in time that they don't get out of hand. I mentioned that before. This is also the management of the cost tracking system is going to lead into a later discussion of the release of funding reserves. My own preference is always to have the PI make that final decision, but my job as PM is to give them good information. So when they make that decision to release funding reserves or not, it's well-grounded, and we know where we stand with unencumbered reserves. You as PM responsible for implementing a scheduling process. I'm going to talk about it a little later that you can find plenty of people that can drive the tools, but it's an unusual planner that understands the work they are scheduling. And the real value added is when that person doing the scheduling comes to you and says, some idiot thinks he's going to do a 20-layer printed circuit board in a week. And you know damn well that's not going to happen. So you, that person, if they understand the work they're planning, can add a considerable amount of value. Let me also make the point back on earned value. Implementing an earned value system within your own shop, it's bad enough. But as the project manager of a discovery mission, you're going to be inputting you're going to be taking in information from all over your team. And so one of the treats you'll need to deal with is, how do I take cost performance metrics from a university that doesn't have an accounting infrastructure set up to track cost against the work breakdown structure? How do I do that? APL and others have come up with techniques using cost-weighted milestones to do that. We're doing the same thing on MMS, but this is a real brain teaser as you get into it. Let's see. Resource management, we've obviously, resources include both programmatic and technical resources. You'll be managing your cost, your schedule. You'll need a reserve, release policy, and plan that uses EVM metrics as an input. But you have to establish some policies about where have I gotten to the point that I'm not going to release any more reserves until without looking at descope options. Now, we'll talk about that a little later, but the use of reserves and margins to buy down risk is a fundamental element of your responsibility as project manager, but you want to do it with a clear vision of what unencumbered reserves you really have to work with and what the consequences can be for dealing with unknown unknowns down the road. First things first, team building. You know, most of us who've managed missions got to that point by coming up through the ranks as design engineers. Maybe we managed a box or an instrument. Maybe later we did a payload, maybe a small mission. And now you're, as a PM, you're at the top of the food chain for project managers. And you think, okay, I'm going to take my great work ethic, and I'm just going to work through everything. And I'm personally going to carry this whole thing on my back. Well, it doesn't work that way. Invest your time instead of in building your team and building your infrastructure and building your processes. Remember that soon you're going to be operating under a formal EVM system in your support staff. And I'm going to talk about a few of the folks that you might not have thought about already, but will make your life miserable if you pick the wrong person, or can make it much easier. I like to draw an analogy between being a Discovery or New Frontiers mission manager and being the chief operating officer of a corporation. In fact, you are managing a $425 million entity, and you have a lot of the same problems as any captain of industry. You've got to keep the customer, the stakeholders happy, you've got to meet the payroll, you've got to deliver a quality product on time and on budget, and you keep your chief executive officer, your PI, happy in the process. These are not easy things to do. But I found that if I could step outside thinking like an engineer and start thinking like a chief operating officer, I had a much easier time building my team, building the infrastructure that would carry us through. There's a couple of key positions that you may or may not have had to think about during your proposal development. These are three that come to mind. First, somebody's got to lead your EVM system. Somebody's got to head up your planning and scheduling process. And somebody, bless their crazy hearts, is going to lead your ITAR process. Okay. I said it right out loud, ITAR. Forgive me, Lord. The common denominator is all these people, of course, need to understand what they're talking about. They need to be experts in the field. They need to have very good people skills because they deal with unpleasant things. And they need to be able to convey unpleasant things in a manner that's not so offensive that it can actually gain cooperation from you. Special things about your EVM person. Not only do they need to understand what's required and how to implement it, but they need to understand the limitations of the tools. Okay? The tools do not produce exact results, mainly because some of the numbers that go in are approximations or their best guesses. And your EVM person needs to be able to implement a system based on an imperfect world which you operate. Your planner and scheduler, I've already mentioned, the key thing there is that they not only understand the tool and how that tool works with other tools to generate earned value reports, but understands the nature of the work that they're scheduling so they can do sanity checks for you up front. Your ITAR lead, whatever you're paying them, it's not enough. Okay? It's a horrible job.
Obviously, they need to know what the law says and how to deal with it, but they need to be able to work with your team on everything from planning a meeting, a review package. If you have international partners, you have international suppliers, ITAR is with you every step of the way, and having the right person in that job can be enormously helpful. Okay, I want to talk very quickly about infrastructure. There's some things that you dealt with, sort of, when you wrote your step one proposal. Maybe you thought things through, maybe you didn't. I usually discover after the fact I'm screwed up. The work breakdown structure, to begin with, we all go to 7120 and look at that appendix in the back and say, okay, that's my work breakdown structure. That's cool. You got to do that or you lose. So you obviously didn't do that. That doesn't mean you can live with it. You may have set that WBS up to make NASA happy, but with no intention of actually using it to do real work. And so before you go forward, as you're writing your concept study report, take another look at it. Be sure that you don't do what I usually do. I end up finding that at WIBS level 5, I've got subcontractors reporting to other subcontractors. Bad plan. Don't do that. Similarly, on your organizational breakdown structure, it's not hard to find yourself in a situation, and I find this, say, for instance, with a mission ops center, where, again, I've got subs reporting to subs and not to me. That doesn't work. You can't have subs giving other subs technical directions. The other area where this gets a little sporty is when you've got international participation. Who are they reporting to? How's that work? We're going to get into a little discussion of reporting here in just a minute. The product breakdown structure. That first question is not a cliche. Do you really know where all the parts are coming from? For instance, do you know whether your sub is planning to sub? They may very well be planning to sub. They get busy, for instance, or maybe they never intended to do the work in-house, but they needed to book the business. Do your subcontractors and their subcontractors know what you expect from them by way of performance and reporting? Are any of those subcontracts large enough that they're going to have an earned value management system? At around $20 million, you're going to have some sort of EVM system, even for your subcontractors. The roadshow. I think we've already talked about that. If we haven't, I can't tell you how important it is to get out of your office, get your project leadership, go out on the road, meet all of your team members and your suppliers, and talk about your expectations for communications, reporting, deliverables, and so forth. But more than that, listen to them. There may be things they can do for you that make your life easier, or there may be things that you're asking that are absolutely impossible. It's not unusual in my experience to find state universities, which have some accounting regulations flow to them by their legislatures, that make it come impossible for them to comply with some of the things you're asking them to do on cost reporting. Looking at your team members' infrastructures may lead you to being able to help them with either training or something related to that. And let me pick up a theme that I've already heard discussed today, and that's this business of trust among team members. When you walk in the door as PM, it cannot be viewed as a punitive action. Your team has to believe you when you say, I'm here to help. When we were working with APL on New Horizons, we had this just magic chemistry that was dumb luck of personalities. But what really paid off was the mutual trust. We could loan them a resource. For instance, when they were busy, we sent QA people to help them. When they were busy, they sent some stress people to help us. Open kimono policy, it works, it makes all the difference. The team has to believe you when you say, I'm here to help. And if they don't believe you, life will be much more difficult. Quickly, earned value management metrics, I've already mentioned this, but remember, earned value management metrics typically are produced by more than one tool working in combination. You'll have a scheduling tool, you'll have a costing tool, and maybe you've got a report writer. Cool. Problem comes about when those three companies that make those tools decide to revise, kick up their tool a rev level, and suddenly it doesn't talk nice. We deal with that almost every day with Cobra and Primavera and Windsight. And so being able to select a set of tools that play nice with each other through the life of the project is critical. The EVM system is imperfect. It is imperfect for very good reasons. It has some imperfect data going into it. Many of your university teammates will not be able to produce cost against the work breakdown structure. You'll be forced to cobble up something that's an approximation of true earned value. Now, granted, if you put enough time, enough thought into it, you can make that work pretty well. And not to pick on anyone, but even the field centers have accounting problems that can be a real complication in trying to implement an Earth value system. There are a whole bunch of switches in EVM system that have to do with the way things are calculated, estimate to complete, estimate at completion, and not to bore you, but these switch settings make a huge difference. The front office at S&D has sent me and others out on more than one occasion to look at missions that were struggling with cost and to see if we could figure out what their estimate to complete was. It is very easy to make the picture look a whole lot better than it is by just setting the switches to forecast everything's going to go well rather than it's going to go about the same. You can see a very different picture. I also want to talk about noise in the system. Noise is, for instance, invoicing. When you're setting up your earned value management system, you may have millions of dollars in purchase parts, and maybe you've planned that out really well, and maybe the contractor screws the whole thing up by not invoicing you or invoicing you early. And the point of this is your metrics, your cost and schedule performance indices can be driven all over the map by the noise in the system. The bottom line here is decide early what you want to do about earnings on parts and subcontracts. Decide where you're going to grant yourself earnings, 0, 50, 100% complete or proportional. These things make a difference. I'm not making this stuff up, folks. You're going to have to live with it every time you turn in a report. All right, these are just some other metrics that you may find useful. Bottom line is, an EVM system can be a good friend. We grew a homemade system back in 96. We used it on image to help us find locations where we were spending too much money for the work we were getting done. That's the whole purpose of all this stuff. If you set it up right, it can give you early warnings. Set it up wrong, it can drive you nuts. You can find yourself spending 4 or 5 days a month writing variance reports that have nothing to do with real work. They have to do with the fact that you put the switch in the wrong position, and you're getting all this noise coming from suppliers, subcontractors, and team members who themselves don't have an earned value accounting system. Enough. Thank you.